worship. So we're taking steps slowly to get back some of the things that we know encourage each other. So this morning as we're gathered, we are starting a new series, a new series of lessons starting this week called Learning Jesus. And we're going to spend some time learning who Jesus is, what it means for us to follow him, what it means for us to become like him, what it is to be his disciple and to follow in his ways. And so I'm very excited about that. And as part of that, we're also going to introduce a new feature to our worship service, which I'm calling the Sunday Stroll. And I've had some people chuckle at that title. It's a kind of a cutesy title, but we're going to be get together with somebody from the church and kind of do a socially distant stroll down on video. I got the idea from some of the sports broadcasts where they walk across the court for the 94 feet and chat with a player. So we'll walk around and just talk a little bit about one of the Beatitudes. So we'll get to do that today, this morning as well. So we got a lot of really cool stuff involved in the worship service this morning. We've got some good news. Lori Colburn, I know a lot of you have been praying for her. She's out of the ICU now. And we're going to keep praying. There's still a lot going on there, but that's a good thing, and we're going to be praying for her. We also have a wedding coming up I don't know how many of you know Cameron Bradley, but his mom, Crystal Reed, goes here, and Cameron is here when he's in town. But Cameron actually grew up going to church down at Central where I was and was in the youth group there, and he's just a fantastic, absolutely fantastic young man. So there's some information about his wedding in the bulletin you can look at as well. So times to celebrate and times to pray for each other and times to walk together and be with each other, all part of the process of learning Jesus, all part of the process of being disciples. So as we think about that this morning, I'm going to invite Gene up here to lead us into communion as we start off our worship service.
The early disciples met on the first day of the week to break bread, to take the Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper forms a central part of our faith. And I'd like to share a verse of scripture, or a couple of verses here, from the end of Paul's book to the Galatians that highlight how important the Lord's Supper is as we think about our relationship with Christ. Listen to this. Galatians 6, beginning with verse 14. But far be it from me to boast except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by which the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. For neither circumcision counts anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creation. And as for all who walk by this rule, peace and mercy be upon them and upon the Israel of God. What does that have to do with the Lord's Supper? Jesus says, do this in remembrance of me until I come. It is the Lord's Supper that we celebrate not only Jesus' sacrifice, but also we celebrate our commitment to that sacrifice in our lives, that we will follow him even if it kills us, if you will. We're going to follow Jesus. That's a lot about learning about who Jesus is and who we as the people of God need to be today. So will you bow with me in prayer as we give thanks for the cup and for the bread? O Lord God, our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the magnificent gift of your Son Jesus, who not only modeled the way of life that he would have us to live, but also showed himself so openly to be sacrificial, Father, in serving you. Help us, Father, as we eat this bread and as we drink this cup, to renew our commitment to live for you, Father, not just when we meet together, but even as we go out into the world, that we might be the hands and feet of Jesus. Thank you so much for this indescribable gift. Thank you for Jesus and for his blood. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Walking here with Marge Brillhart, and we're just talking about the Beatitudes.
Of course, Marge, I didn't give you any time to prepare for this stroll at all.
Absolutely none.
But basically, you know, the Beatitudes are this teaching where Jesus says, blessed are you if you're, and he says something bad. Blessed are you if you're poor, blessed are you if you're weak.
Morning.
When you think about that, is that a blessing? Why does Jesus think it's a blessing? I mean, how does it make you feel that he's saying, when you're weak, you're blessed?
The first time, or early on when I would read it, it made me feel awful. I didn't understand the poor in spirit. I mean, it seemed to me like it was all backwards. And then I read the rest of it. Because you will be. You will be comforted. You will have peace. You will have these things. And it became a journey toward something incredibly positive and hopeful.
That's a really cool way of looking at it.
And so I don't look at the first part because I don't understand most of the first part. But I get the second part. And that's what I want.
I like that. So when we think about what the Beatitudes mean to us, we kind of have two parts of the story.
Yes.
The valleys in life and the mountains.
Mm-hmm.
And God kind of says, when you're in the valley, don't worry, because I'm bringing a mountain.
And the valleys aren't going to make sense. And so the first part doesn't have to make sense to me.
Well, there you have it.
Because I don't see what I'm going through at the time. It's after you get out and you look back that you see the value of it and the reason for it.
There's our Sunday afternoon socially distant stroll with Marge Brillhart.
Luke 19, 1 through 10. Jesus entered Jericho and made his way through the town. There was a man there named Zacchaeus. He was the chief tax collector in the region, and he had become very rich. He tried to get a look at Jesus, but he was too short to see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree beside the road, for Jesus was going to pass that way. When Jesus came by, he looked up at Zacchaeus and called him by name. Zacchaeus, he said, quick, come down. I must be a guest in your home today. Zacchaeus quickly climbed down and took Jesus to his house in great excitement and joy. But the people were displeased. He is gone to be the guest of a notorious sinner, they grumbled. Meanwhile, Zacchaeus stood before the Lord and said, I will give half my wealth to the poor, Lord, and if I have cheated people on their taxes, I will give them back four times as much. Jesus responded, salvation has come to this home today, for this man has shown himself to be a true son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and save those who were lost.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody here and a few new faces here for the first time. BJ, you're back there now. Glad that you could be there. Is that BJ? I thought it is. Your disguise has me thrown a little bit. Early Halloween preparation, I guess. Maybe that's it. Glad to be here with you this morning and for our ongoing desire to try to move back toward what so many of us want so desperately in our worship context. Today, we begin a series that will take us through the rest of the year. We're calling it Learning Jesus. Learning Jesus, in my mind, carries the idea that we look to Him to become everything that He is. Not just that we learn about Him, but that we put into place our values and our priorities based on who He is and based on our calling as His disciples. I love the text in the book of Hebrews. You perhaps know this, but a little reminder won't matter, that Hebrews is best described as a sermon. The author of Hebrews says that he's writing them a word of exhortation, which is another way of saying I'm preaching you a sermon. So it's an early written Christian sermon that we have. And in this sermon, he begins in the first few lines by talking about who Jesus is and what God has done through him. It's really somewhat interesting that in most of our English translations, that the first four verses of Hebrews is probably going to be broken up into two, three, or four, or five sentences. But in the original language the author wrote this sermon in, it's one sentence. And it's a sentence, it's almost like he just begins describing Jesus and he goes on and on and on and he can't stop. He thinks of this one idea and another idea and he just keeps laying it on. So he says this, "In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets at many times and in various ways, but in these last days, he's spoken to us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things and through whom he made the heavens or the universe. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being." That's what I want us to pause and think about. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being. It's awfully easy for us sometimes to get wrapped up in studying God and studying about God, that if we're not really careful, we come away with a picture of God as being somewhat like this and a picture of Jesus as being somewhat like this, whereas the author of Hebrews says, if you want to know who God is and what God is like, look at Jesus. And it's easy for us to develop a theology about the nature of God and completely forget that the best way to understand God is to look at Jesus. Who is Jesus? He'll tell us who our God is. So the author of Hebrews, again, time and again, will point us back in chapter 3 and verse 1, "Fix your thoughts on Jesus." And lest we forget, chapter 12 in verse 2, "Fix your eyes on Jesus." So Christians have a hero, and our hero is Jesus. And our hero is Jesus because he tells us who God is. So we look to Jesus to learn everything that we want to know about God. There was this one occasion when Jesus' disciples, Philip particularly, was maybe a little bit disenchanted or discouraged or confused. I'm not sure what his state of mind was. But maybe out of frustration, he just spoke up and said, "Jesus, if you would just show us the Father, we'd be satisfied." And Jesus said, "Well, Philip, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father." So the best way for us to know God is to know Jesus. So that's what we want to do. We want to learn Jesus so that we can know more about this great God who created us and put us here and controls all that there is about life and death. We know about this God as we learn about Jesus. Somebody has said that we can be right about Jesus and wrong about the Bible and be okay. But you can't be wrong about Jesus and right about the Bible and be okay. Now, I'm sure we could push that to extremes, and we might be uncomfortable if we push that too far, because obviously Scripture and Jesus are united in their testimony. But I have known some people who profess to know the Bible quite well, who did not appear to me as if they knew Jesus from the way they talked and the way they acted and the way that they treated people. So we want to know Jesus. One time in Paul's writings in Ephesians chapter 4, as he was trying to get these new Christians in the faith to mature and become the kind of people that they needed to be, he looked at some of their behavior, and his rebuke to them was, "You didn't learn that from Jesus. You didn't pick up that kind of activity by looking at Jesus." Implying that Jesus is our model. He is the one you and I are called to imitate. So this series of sermons is designed to help us focus on Jesus, learn about him, and put into practice the values that we see in his life. So today, we're going to begin with what we could have begun with, a number of sections, and we'll limit the series to the rest of the year, just 12 or 13 sermons. But today, his mission. Why did he come? What was the mission of Jesus? Now, there are a lot of places that we could turn to. One would be the reading that Adam shared with us from Luke chapter 19 in verse 10, where Jesus said of himself, "The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost." But another place we can look is Luke's story. In Luke chapter 3, beginning with the baptism of Jesus and continuing through chapter 4, it's there toward the middle of Luke chapter 3 that we find Luke recording Jesus' baptism. And then we'll continue looking a little bit more on through chapter 4. It's in the baptism of Jesus that the identity of Jesus is revealed. He is God's Son. Now, I've been told that people who really did not know that my son and I had any blood relations, upon learning that he's my son or I'm his dad, their response was something like, "Oh yeah, well I obviously that's true." They talk about this beautiful chin that protrudes in exact proportions as it's supposed to. And the eyes that seem to have the same way of looking at someone. The facial features and even some of the mannerisms I've noticed as Joshua continues to mature, that he's maturing in a wonderful kind of way as he looks and acts more like his old man. Jesus was described as God's son. In the ancient world, that term son carried a little bit more than it does in our world. We tend to think son more in just biological terms. But in the ancient world, the word son carried more than just that biological connotation. It carried ideas of authority and power and representation. So much so that a son, if he gave his word about something, he was automatically giving his word the word of the Father. So when Jesus comes as God's son, it's not just biology we're talking about. Actually, we're not talking about biology at all there, are we? We're talking about Jesus being a representative, an emissary, a spokesperson with the full authority of God. That is, God has put his stamp of approval on Jesus, who he was and what he did. So Jesus is proclaimed by the heavenly voice when he was baptized, "This is my beloved Son, and I am really pleased in him." So Jesus' mission required him, after he was baptized and then throughout his life, required him to do business with and for the Father, but also to do business with Satan. Every child of God is called to do business with the Father and to do business with Satan. So in doing business with the Father, he was baptized in answering the prophet John's call. But in doing business with Satan, he goes out into the wilderness. And he faces everything that Satan can throw at him. To demonstrate whose son he really is. It's easy to say yes to God, but it's harder to say no to Satan. And that's what Jesus is called to do. Not only to say yes to God, but to say no to Satan. A lot of times you and I have recognized ourselves how that Christians can very quickly in the media, in the public venue, say yes to being a child of God. But we also see how they sometimes have difficulty saying no to Satan. So you've got to do business with both. Do business with the Father and do business with Satan. So when Jesus is in the wilderness, Satan throws three temptations at him, which was a number for completion. That is, he throws everything that he has to try to get Jesus to compromise his mission. But what Jesus does in the wilderness is he quotes three texts to Satan, not just any texts, but texts, all of them coming from Deuteronomy 6 through 10. Those five chapters, which are recognized as being Israel's wilderness manual. When Moses reflects on Israel's journey in the wilderness, preparing them to go into the promised land, repeating to them who they are as the people of God, in this section of Deuteronomy 6 through 10, it's called the wilderness manual because this is how Israel was called to live in the wilderness. So when Jesus is confronted by Satan, three times out in the wilderness, he quotes from Israel's wilderness manual. Jesus knew the scriptures. He knew how a child of God, a son of God, would live when he's in the wilderness being confronted by Satan. The wilderness is a place of danger, a place where you're vulnerable without the right tools. So Jesus demonstrated that he had the right tools. He would deal with Satan with the tools that God gave him to deal with Satan. And those were the scriptures as the Son of God and as Jesus prepared for his mission. He dealt with Satan in the same way that Israel had been called to deal with their development in the desert. Satan does leave Jesus, but not permanently. He does leave Jesus, and he knows where Jesus' devotion and loyalties were. So you and I, as we do business with the Father and as we do business with Satan, we need to recognize that's an essential part of our mission as well. Then Jesus leaves the wilderness and he goes to his hometown, Nazareth, preaches the first sermon that we have that he preached when he launched his public ministry. And he begins by getting the scroll of Isaiah. He rolls the scroll to the right section and reads two verses that were so important to the Israelite people, to the Jewish people of the first century. These two verses were kind of, as they had developed over the centuries, had kind of become a John 3:16 of the Old Testament to them. Virtually every little Israelite boy and girl knew these two verses as they grew up. So Jesus quoted golden texts from the Bible. They came from Isaiah chapter 61. Jesus read this, the first sermon. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Then Jesus rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant who ever so carefully cared for the Word of God by protecting it and putting it in its right place. And when everything was finished, it's total silence in the synagogue. And Jesus said, today, these words are fulfilled. And then he starts his sermon. And when he finishes the sermon, he found out that not everybody was really happy with him. Because Jesus defined his mission not just as a mission to the Israelite people, but a mission to the entire world. Jesus proclaimed that his mission is to love everybody, just as God demonstrated his love and compassion for people outside of the Jewish race as well. The nature of Jesus' mission here is presented as a powerful mission. A mission of good news for the poor. A mission that would offer freedom for prisoners and for the oppressed and for the healing of the sick. But it was a mission that went outside the Jewish race. Some people had so made peace with their limitations and their misunderstandings that they didn't appreciate his mission. There was an understanding that God loves the Jewish people more than he loved anybody else on the earth, that their culture, their race, their language, their values, their religion, their covenants, that they were more important than anybody else. And Jesus presented a God who had assigned to him a mission that valued everybody equally. That's why Jesus referred to two stories from the Old Testament, two characters who were non-Jews, demonstrating that God loved them and cared for them. And so upset people in his first sermon, they tried to kill him. I remember my first sermon. It was a masterpiece. Perfect in every way. I had all of 5 minutes to prepare for it. Because on the spot, when I arrived at church, I was asked to say something. Not one person, though it came from the mouth of a 16-year-old, not one person threw anything at me. Not one person rebuked me. Not one person offered a critique in any way except, "We are so proud of you." But Jesus preached his first sermon and they wanted him dead. You see, the mission of God can be dangerous. When Jesus revealed his mission, people were so upset that they wanted him dead and attempted to kill him, and would have if they'd had the opportunity. So this mission that Jesus brought into the world is a dangerous mission. It's a mission that carries tremendous risk for the person who proclaims the mission. It's not a popular mission. At least it wasn't for Jesus. It actually was a mission that ended up getting him killed. But as you learn about Jesus, we need to recognize the mission that we engage ourselves in, the mission that we commit ourselves to, the mission that we say we will also be a part of, is a mission of great risk and danger. Then in chapter 4, as Luke continues telling the story about Jesus beginning his mission, he tells us that mission is not just something that where you do business with God and Satan out in the wilderness alone. Mission is not just something that you preach in a synagogue and you find out nobody likes it. Mission is actually something that you do. Mission requires engagement with people. So Jesus, after he left the synagogue, goes out and finds a demon-possessed person, or the demon-possessed person approaches him, and Jesus casts the demon out. Jesus did business with Satan, and then he did business with Satan's emissaries, the demons. Dreams are often dreamed without a lot of effort. It can be that you and I go to bed at night with nothing on our minds and we wake up the next morning only to find out, "I dreamed something last night. Where did that come from? I mean, I slept through the night and this person was on my mind, or this happened and I've not thought about that. That was not on my mind." Dreams don't require a lot of effort. But dreams, if they're going to become reality, do require a lot of effort. If Jesus had only dreamed about what God had called him to do, that first sermon probably would not have been a threat to him. Jesus, if he'd only dreamed, probably would have been no different than dozens of others who came before him and after him with a mission of hope. But Jesus put flesh on the mission. Jesus put, as we sometimes hear it said, boots on the ground and began activating the mission. He put some skin in the game. He confronted Satan. He confronted the demon who had controlled humans, and the people were amazed at it. He looked for people to help, not waiting to be found, but eagerly finding people who were poor, who were prisoners, who were oppressed. And he engaged them in a way that demonstrated his power over them. The physically challenged, he provided help and healing. The sick, like Peter's mother-in-law, he healed. His mission was to heal and offer a better way, a way where dreams become realities. So the mission of Jesus is to provide hope for the entire world, where the entire world could be saved. Not just saved from their sin, though that was a huge part of it, but saved from the pain, from the agony, from the burdens, from the oppression, from the being locked up. Jesus offered hope. Jesus challenges us, if we commit to that mission, to offer words of hope to people as well. To do business with God and with Satan, but then to, in our proclamation, actually get out where the people are. You know, that's probably one of the greatest challenges the average person faces on a day-to-day basis, is figuring out how we in our own individual selves can actually do mission. What we can do in the lives of a neighbor or of a friend. What we can do just because we're Christians. Where we can go and what we can say. So, I wonder, as an opportunity for you to provide response to me, do you think Christians are faithful to Jesus' mission today? And I'd love some explanation of that from you. Do you think that we're doing mission in a way that represents the way that, or duplicates the way that Jesus did it? And another way, perhaps, or another question you might think about responding to, what does the church today need to do to engage Jesus' mission more faithfully in the way that he engaged it? I'd love to hear from you as we take a break and come back in a moment to part two, your responses.
Good morning, church. Let's prepare our hearts and minds as we enter this time of prayer. Heavenly Father, we lift your name on high and praise you for all the blessings that you bestow upon us. We ask for your wisdom and discernment in all decisions that we make so we can follow you more closely. Oh God, there are times that we feel lost in this life. We know that through your immense love, you will never leave us or forsake us. Father, show us our gifts and give us the strengths so we can use them to be a blessing to others. We ask for your healing hand upon this church and especially those on our prayer list. Heavenly Father, we ask forgiveness when we stray from your plan. Thank you for loving us so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Then Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this household." Luke 19:9.
The Storm That Stopped, written by Allison Mitchell. One day long ago, Jesus was teaching people by the sea. Soon, some more people arrived. Then others, then more and more, until there were people everywhere. The crowds were just too big. "We can't hear back here. Give me some room." No one could see Jesus, and no one could hear Jesus. "Be quiet. I can't see." So Jesus asked his friends, the disciples, to push their boat out onto the water. He sat in the boat, and the huge crowd spread out along the beach. Now they could all see and hear Jesus as he told them all about God. When he finished teaching the people, Jesus said to his friends, "Let's go over to the other side of the sea." Jesus had finished teaching the crowd, and now he had something to teach his friends. But they didn't know it yet, so they all jumped in the boat with him and set sail across the sea. Jesus was so tired. He'd been teaching the people all day, so he lay down in the back of the boat and fell fast asleep. It was a quiet evening. The water gently lapped against the boat, and the sun slowly set in the sky. Jesus was sleeping, The disciples were quietly talking. Then all of a sudden, they were in the middle of the biggest, loudest, scariest, most ginormous storm you could imagine. The wind blew hard. The waves grew huge. The water poured into the boat. But Jesus was asleep. The wind blew harder. The waves grew huger. The water filled the boat, but Jesus was still asleep. Jesus, wake up, wake up. We're drowning. Don't you care? What a silly thing to say to Jesus. Of course he cared. He loved his friends so much that one day he was going to die for them. Jesus stood up in the boat. The wind was still blowing. The waves were bigger than ever. The water was pouring into the boat quicker than the disciples could tip it out again. The boat was sinking. But then Jesus did something amazing. He didn't help his friends pour the water out of the boat. He didn't help them try to row back to land. Jesus simply spoke. But he didn't speak to the disciples. He spoke to the storm, to the wind, and to the waves. Quiet! Be still! Just three little words. And the storm stopped. Right away, at that very moment, the sea was quiet, still, and calm. Then Jesus looked at his friends. Why are you so afraid? Do you still not trust me? But they were terrified, and they asked each other, who is this? Even the waves and wind do what he says. That is what Jesus wanted to teach them. He wanted them to know who he really is. The disciples already knew a lot about God from his special book. They knew that God made everything. He made the world, he made the sun and the moon and the stars, and he made the sea and the wind as well. They knew that only God can tell the sea what to do, that only God can tell the wind when to blow or the waves when to crash. Only God can do these things. But the disciples had just seen Jesus do the same thing God can do. So what is the answer to their question? Who is Jesus? Jesus is God.
Good morning, church. Jesus rescues. Over and over throughout the Bible, we see Jesus rescuing people from harm and illness and disease. And in this particular instance, we see Jesus rescuing the disciples from a storm. In this rescue, his disciples recognize a godly power over creation. They see that in this man standing beside them, God. And they recognized God's power because they had heard the stories of how God had saved the Israelites. They knew those stories. And here they see godly power in this man who is their friend. Jesus is our friend too. We can be rescued as well. Our storms might not be physical. Our storms might be storms of chaos, but Jesus can rescue us because he's peace. Our storms might be darkness, but Jesus can rescue us because he's light. Our storms might be storms of lies and pain, but Jesus can rescue us because he is truth and he is goodness and kindness and gentleness. This week, if you find yourself in the midst of storms, storms of life, remember that Jesus can rescue you.
A friend that I respect quite a lot said something that he decided on years ago when he was a much younger man. And I'm putting it in my own words because what he said has inspired me. But there came this point, a transition point in his life, when he had to decide the kind of person he was going to be. And roughly what he said was that he made up his mind that he would do what Jesus did, that he would be who Jesus was, that he would say what Jesus said, that he would go where Jesus went, that he would just be Jesus. In one sense, that sounds awfully elementary. In another sense, that is exactly who we're called to be and what we're called to do, to be Jesus. That's not always easy. It's not always easy to say what needs to be said, especially in certain contexts when you know it's not going to be very popular. But to be Jesus to our world calls for us to learn Jesus. I heard a world-renowned, internationally famous scholar say this past week in an interview, when he was asked in his preaching career, what would he do if he could begin preaching again? What would he do differently? And his answer was, I would preach more out of the Gospels than I did my first time through. And that answer is one where he is saying, I would try my best to lift up Jesus as the person that we need to know. I would want people to be right about Jesus, to understand who he is. Because you cannot be right about God unless you understand Jesus. So that's the call that we all share. I have a couple of texts, maybe three, that have come in. As everybody knows, this happens live, so I read them as they come in. Brichet says, I believe that in worshiping God, we as a church body do well. However, when challenged, we tend to fall short due to the shock and hurting the challenge can do. I mean that as a church, as individuals, though not as a group. Thank you, Brichet, for writing in. Aiden Cooper says, let's see, yep, just... I thought maybe there were two texts from Aiden, but there's just one. I think you already know my answer to those questions, given our conversations the past few weeks. I don't think Christians are doing as good a job fulfilling God's mission as they could. I think we focus too much on what is going on inside the church building without giving enough time and effort to what goes on outside the building. Aiden, I do appreciate the conversations that we have had, particularly the one a couple of weeks ago. What we do inside this building should more than anything be kind of like a going to a pep rally. That we come here and we get a word of inspiration, a word of encouragement, where we come together as the people of God to say, yeah, life out there is tough, but let's remember who we are. And when we leave here, let's go out and be who we're called to be. If all we do as Christians takes place within these four walls, then we're really not engaging the mission as Jesus engaged it and called us to imitate him in doing so. So, Aiden, I appreciate your comment. I think that you're right on track in what you have said. And let's see, from Andy and Andrea Leonard. Y'all did not know they were still alive, did you? They are, and they're doing well. A good lesson this morning. I was listening on a kayak at Lake Chickamauga in Dayton, Tennessee. Okay, that's the first kayak listener we've had, to the best of my knowledge. But welcome aboard to join us, Andy. We appreciate that. I was reminded of the way that the mission can take flesh this week. And I'll toss this out to you if you have skills that I don't have. I'm not much of a carpenter. I actually drove some nails that were huge in diameter to put together some railroad ties to create a garden frame. And I managed to bend those huge nails. I mean, they're this long, and I don't know how big around they are. Look like maybe at least a quarter inch. And I can bend nails without even trying. But I got a call this past week, a lady in Leadbetter who is elderly. She has health restrictions. She has, as I understand it, a wheelchair ramp that she needs to be able to use, and her doors to her house, the back door to the wheelchair ramp, if I understand it correctly, has stuck, and she cannot get it open. She's had a 21 or 2 year old grandson to attempt to get the door open, and he's unable to get the door open. I don't know if the door has expanded. Maybe it needs planing so that it can open. I have no idea. But her front door sticks really bad also, so she is stuck in her house and cannot get either front or back door open under her own power. I don't know what I'm getting into. It sounds simple enough if you have carpentry skills. I don't possess those very much. I'm the kind of guy who hits it with a shoulder, and if it won't open, you know, we got a problem, Houston. But I wonder if somebody here would like to go see her and see if you could figure out what's going on. I think that's one of the ways that the mission of God takes flesh, that it pulls us out of our schedule and puts us into someone else's environment where we try to help. Could you imagine being in this lady's position where she said, if there were a fire in my house, I don't think I could get out? I think that seems to me to be something that Jesus would engage. So many times we tend to think about the church's mission as being an elaborate program that involves these huge events that would involve hundreds or thousands of people participating, where there's a lot of recognition and maybe some cameras flowing, and where we're all inspired and encouraged. I'd like to suggest that maybe more often than not, mission is something you do and nobody ever sees it. They never recognize that you were there, except maybe the person that you were helping. They may never know what was really taking place, but you did something to make a difference in someone's life. And maybe while you're there, you pass along the words, something like, I just sensed that Jesus was the one who would like for me to come over and see if I could fix your door. And it may be putting in that word for Jesus, they know everything that they need to know, that you're a man or a woman of God who's committed to living like Jesus lived his life. So the mission of Jesus in learning Jesus is that we learn to engage the world and participate by making a difference in the lives of people, one person at a time or a small group at a time. So I encourage you to reflect this coming week on the mission that Jesus had, that of being God to the world, that of showing the world what God would be doing if he were here in the flesh. And in reality, theologically speaking, the church is God's flesh today. So let's be his people. Gene, you have a word of blessing for us?
I found your title and theme very challenging. Learning Jesus, his mission. I want you to think about two things. One, learning Jesus. What have you learned personally in following Jesus? It would be a good exercise, I'm telling you. What have you learned in following Jesus? As I was thinking about, I just listed a few things myself. I have learned, for example, you have to let go many times of your plans and dreams for the future to reach God's plans for your life. Sometimes disappointment comes and your life is shattered. But if you can find God's way, you can find fulfillment. Number two, treat all people with love and respect, especially those who have hurt you. How many of us have learned that by experience? Much better to love rather than hate. Number three, forgiveness is the most effective way of freeing you from anger and resentment. When our lives are filled with resentment, we are tied inseparably to the person who hurt us. Whereas if you can let it go, I want you to think about, what have you learned in your life from Jesus? And then in terms of his mission, I challenge us all. If you're going to be involved in the mission of Jesus, it is to seek and to save that which was lost. Those who have been, their lives have been lost, their lives have been shattered, they have been spoiled, they've been ruined, and our world is filled with people who, through drugs, alcohol abuse, bad choices that they've made, their lives are just in shambles. How can we be Jesus to those people? First thing I'm going to tell you is that we need to put ourselves in a position to be around those people. We need to be involved in things like Starfish Orphan Ministry, or Paducah Cooperative Ministry, or Hope Clinic, or Ladies Living Free. There are any number of organizations in our various communities that we could be a part of and make a difference. And for those of us that are listening from other areas in West Kentucky, let me share one other resource for you. If you will write down this website, it's purchasehealthconnections.com. You can find out for any county in West Kentucky in the Purchase area of needs that are out there, and find out resources that are there. And you can put yourself right in that place. So if we're going to be a part of the ministry of Jesus, we've got to put ourselves in a position to help people. May God help us to be looking for those opportunities so that we can truly be the hands and feet of Jesus today. Let's pray. Lord, help us to look for the opportunities that are all around us of serving those people whose lives, through bad choices of their own or through circumstances, have their lives in shambles and are looking for help or looking for hope. And may we give the help and the hope that Jesus gave when he walked this earth. Bless us as we seek to be a church without walls that ministers into our communities. For this is our prayer in the name of Jesus. Amen.